Technically speaking, earthquake waves are actually called seismic waves. This is the way I'm actually going to refer to them most of the time. Seismic waves are shock waves that transmit through the Earth and along the Earth's surface because of movement along a fault line, volcanic activity, and even underground nuclear explosions. The machine we use to detect seismic activity, in other words, earthquake activity, is called a seismogram. You can see this on the right-hand side. It's a drum that has paper attached to it. And you can see that there's a long pipe-like cylinder that allows this drum to slowly rotate. Then there's a needle with ink in it that scratches along the surface of this paper that's attached to the drum. The seismogram is the thing you plug into the wall. It's the instrument, it's the machine. Then what happens is when there's an earthquake, the earthquake is recorded onto a seismograph. The seismograph is that paper. It's the record of seismic or earthquake activity, which you see down at the bottom. There are two types of seismic waves, and then each of those two types of seismic waves have subtypes. The first type of seismic wave is called the body wave or body waves. These are the waves that transmit through the Earth. Literally, an earthquake happens, and on the other side of the planet, a place where there's a seismogram will pick up the fact that the earthquake occurred. They won't feel it, but the machine will pick it up. And there are two types of body waves. First is the P wave, which is the primary wave. They travel the fastest. They are detected first at the seismic station. A seismic station is a place with a seismogram, like Caltech in Pasadena, for example. The P waves transmit through all types of materials. They speed up and slow down as they go through materials of different densities. That means as the wave is going from one layer to the next layer inside the planet, if the layer is denser, the velocity of the wave will increase. If the layer is less dense, the velocity of the wave will slow down. And they are refracted as they move through different types of material. Refract means bend. Reflect is bounce straight back. So as they go from one layer to the next, they bend. The other type of body wave is called the S wave or secondary wave. You can guess where this is going to be in terms of arrival. They move slower than the P waves and are detected second at the seismic station. They do not transmit through liquids. I'm not talking about water. I'm talking about liquid rock, what at this point you may very well call lava, but is really magma. It's so hot that the rock is liquefied. And there is an increasing time interval between the arrival of the P wave and the S wave at the seismic station as distance is increased from the epicenter. What that means is this. If you and I were both at Santa Ana College and we were taking our cars and driving to Las Vegas, and we left at the same moment, Tuesday at 9 a.m. from Santa Ana College, if my car was able to average 75 miles an hour and your car was able to average 50 miles an hour, even though we left at the same moment, after 1 hour, I would be 75 miles along the road, you would be 50 miles along the road, and I would be 25 miles in front of you. After 2 hours, I would be 150 miles along the road, and you would be 100 miles along the road. Now you would be 50 miles behind me. Our distance between each other would be increasing because I am moving at a more rapid velocity. These waves work the same way, so that if you are very close to the epicenter, when the earthquake happens, the P wave comes in, boom, 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 and that's followed rapidly by the S wave, boom, 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 boom. However, if you are a couple thousand miles away, the P wave comes in, boom, 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 and then you sit and you wait. And you wait, and you wait, and you wait, and you wait, and you still wait. And then, boom, 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 in comes the S wave, because they are traveling at different velocities. If you're lying in your bed and an earthquake begins, you know that first little bit of shaking you feel? Rumble, rumble, rumble. And then you're thinking, do I need to get up? Well, that's the P wave. Take a look at this diagram here. You can see this is a seismograph. And you can see the arrival of the P wave. And then you can see the arrival of the S wave. So the S wave is arriving at this seismogram, at this seismic station, after the P wave. The other types of waves are called the surface waves. These, like the name indicates, travel along the surface. And the surface waves are the things that cause the destruction. So when you feel that P wave and you're thinking about whether you need to get up, what you're waiting for that's going to determine that is the arrival of the surface waves. There are two types of surface waves. First, the L wave or love wave or longitudinal wave. Longitudinal means it's going along the surface like longitude does. Love is because in science, when you discover something or you come up with something, it gets named after you. The characteristics of the L wave are that they move horizontally outwards from the epicenter. That means back and forth, not up and down, back and forth. And they give the rattling effect to an earthquake. The other type of surface wave is called the R wave. The R wave is the Rayleigh wave. This is named after a very famous scientist. They move vertically outwards from the epicenter, in other words, up and down, and they give the rolling effect to an earthquake. If you've been in an earthquake, or multiple earthquakes, especially, you know that there are rattling earthquakes and there are rolling earthquakes. You can imagine if you have the back and forth and the up and down hitting your house simultaneously, this is not good for the structural integrity of your building.